with nuts over our slippers.
You go ahead, Dorothy. He who hesitates, et cetera, et cetera. I'd like to speak to the Wiz.
Hey, Mike!
That was a scene from The Wiz with Diana Ross and her fellow travelers off to see The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. And we'll see scenes from The Wiz and four other movies on Sneak Previews, a show where two critics talk about and sometimes argue about the new movies in town. Across the aisle from me is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune and CBS TV News in Chicago.
And this is Roger Ebert, the Pulitzer Prize-winning film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Now, in addition to The Wiz, Roger and I will be reviewing what we both agree is one of the most stunningly beautiful films we've ever seen, Days of Heaven. And in the comedy, Who is Killing the Great Chefs of Europe, we both like the performance of an actor best known for his TV commercials. That's Robert Morley. We'll also review Girlfriends, about two young women trying to make it in New York City. But first, Roger begins with a detective film I think we're going to be arguing about. It's Richard Dreyfuss in The Big Fix.
You think so, right, Gene? Mm-hmm. The Big Fix gives us a new kind of private eye, a 60s radical whose latest case forces him to re-examine what he thinks he's believed for the last 15 years. Richard Dreyfuss plays the detective. His name is Moses Wine, and he was at Berkeley with a guy who disappeared into the underground years ago. But when it looks as though the guy has resurfaced to sabotage a political campaign, Dreyfuss is brought into the case by an old girlfriend.
Look, I've got some people here. If it worries you so much, just take care of it yourself, all right? Moses Wine?
Mm-hmm.
Hi, I'm Sam Sebastian, Southern California coordinator. What happened to your hand?
Bar fight with a butcher.
Oh, here, sit down.
Listen, I'm sorry to get you out so
late.
That's okay. The longer I stayed at home, the poorer I was getting.
Listen, I'm very happy you're showing so much support for Hawthorne.
Well, it's
the man California needs. Let's face
hold,
it.
Hold, save it for the kids in the 18th precinct, okay? It's a little late in the day for political hoo-ha.
You don't care who wins this campaign, do you?
You said it.
Okay. What do you know about the underground? We need someone who can move in that world, someone who will be trusted. I understand you are the man. Now, what do you know about the underground?
What everybody else does.
You went to Berkeley, didn't you?
That's right.
Didn't you know some of them personally?
That's not true. I just knew people who knew people like everybody else.
What about Howard Eppes?
What about Howard Eppes? Brothers and sisters and fellow Californians, join with me in supporting Miles Hawthorne for governor. I have spoken with the congressman, and I am convinced he can teach us to cooperate the way others have done in Europe and Asia. Back a man who backs the people, share the wealth, vote for Hawthorne, Howard Eppes. It's not funny.
Do you realize what that can do to us in Orange County? Share the wealth?
Well, did he talk with the congressman?
Of course not. My problem is finding out who's behind this, whether it's Eppes or not, and stopping him fast. And if it's a Dilworthy smear, I want everybody to know about it.
Well, it turns out that Dreyfuss knew Howard Eppes in the old days, and so did we, sort of. The movie has a lot of characters we can almost recognize. Eppes, for example, reminds us of Abby Hoffman. And there's a married couple who sort of seem inspired by William and Emily Harris. And even the candidate has a sneaky resemblance to Jerry Brown. The Big Fix mixes up two major ingredients. It's half and half. It's private eye cliches and everyday Southern California craziness. And Dreyfuss makes a hip and believable private eye. The movie's plot is incredibly complicated, but private eye movies are supposed to be incredibly complicated. And The Big Fix develops its characters as carefully as its complications.
Well, if private eye flicks are supposed to be complicated, there's another thing that they should be, and that is they should make us want to care about the solution of the crime. And every time I felt that this picture took off, whammo, another message, and only one message here, which is that you should be politically involved and you should be ashamed of being unpolitically involved. And I really don't need to be told that. It's rather obvious we should take control of our lives.
I don't think the message has that much to do with the movie, and I also don't, you know, most of the time in private eye movies, I don't really care about the solution of the crime. It's the process. It's getting there, introducing the characters, the investigation, the dialogue, the eccentric people the private eye comes across. That's more fun than who did
it. Yes, except he interrupts it. And, oh, it's real clear, Raj, that he wants to teach us something. We have a scene of him standing in front of a moviola looking at old 68 footage and crying.
I took that more as atmosphere.
It was real heavy atmosphere, real heavy humidity, I think. But anyway, now we come to a film that has no messages. It's just plain fun. It's the comedy mystery Who is Killing the Great Chefs of Europe, starring Robert Morley. It's about time Morley stopped with the airline commercials, I think, and made a movie, and he's just terrific here as the autocratic head and stomach of an international gourmet magazine. He's a regular tyrant at his office.
Beecham! Beecham! Why do I have to call you three times?
I'm right here, Mr.
Van. I thought I told you I wanted Lorette out of the way before I came in this morning.
That girl's been here for 3 years.
I tell you, I found a jar of peanut butter in her desk.
No, never mind.
Paper cups in here. Peanut butter, Beecham.
What were you doing in her desk?
Skeffington, what the devil is that?
It's an idea I had for our January cover, Mr. Vanderveer.
It is a monstrosity. That wouldn't stimulate the appetite of a starving boar constrictor. I want flesh, you Philistine. Flesh, or it's back to passport photos where you belong. Oh, Ola, that's simply charming, dear. You think it needs just a little more on top? Beecham. Take one star away from Chez Auguste. I dined there last night and generated more gas than the Middle East produces in a month.
Ah, Mr. Vanderveer.
What is it now, Bussingbird?
I've just had an absolute brainstorm for our Easter issue. What would you think to recreating the menu of the Last Supper?
Brainstorm is right. That is, without doubt, Bussingbird, the single most tasteless, vulgar, and macabre suggestion it has ever been my misfortune to hear. What next, I wonder? The Andes plane crash cookbook?
He's just wonderful there, and he'll be remembered at Academy Award time. Now, the next big cover story for Morley's magazine is a feature about the world's greatest meal, with each course being prepared by a great chef from a different European country. Suddenly, though, the famous chefs begin turning up dead, stewed, as it were, in their own juices. And that really worries Jacqueline Bisset, playing a pastry chef from England, scheduled to create the dessert. Now, late in the film, George Siegel, Bisset's estranged husband, chases her through a television station where she's fixing her specialty. Siegel's afraid his wife's flaming dessert might blow up in her face. But the big question is, can Siegel get to the right TV studio in time? Unfortunately, a soap opera gets in his way.
And now for the fiery finale, as promised. We start with a bottle of framboise, the divine raspberry liqueur.
I was too busy. Oh, excuse me, Henry. You were too busy. Whenever I wanted to talk to you, you were never there.
A was never there. Ah, no, Pamela. As it happens, you were never there.
I mean, when I was there, Henry, you weren't there. You were always at the office.
Well, what was I supposed to do? Resign my position? Who the hell are you? Do you know where the cooking show is?
Get that fool off my set, for Christ's sake!
Excuse me, do you know where the cooking show is?
Get off my set!
Just leaving.
Nigel, what is going on around here? Look, I really thought I had something that time.
Yeah, darling, don't get your knickers in a twist.
Because you have cues on time and anything, well, I guess.
Now I'm going to pour the heated framboise into the crown and around the bone.
Take three.
The cooking show! Where the hell is it?
On the second floor.
This is the second floor!
Yes, I see. In America, this is the second floor. Yes, but here in England, this is actually the first floor. Your first floor being what we call the main or ground floor. Now, your third floor, in reality, is our second floor, if you see what I mean. Now, if you'd like me to run through that again, I'd...
Ah! Now, here's the moment we've all been waiting for.
Natasha, don't! For God's sake, don't!
Now, that's late in the movie, but don't worry, we didn't give away anything. There's lots more to that scene. And fortunately, unlike the big fix, Unfortunately, there are no great messages to this picture. It's just a good time at the movies. Good time, good food, we see some great restaurants, good acting, particularly by 70-year-old Robert Morley.
I agree with you there. In fact, I'm going to make a prediction right now, an Academy Award nomination, Best Supporting Actor to Robert Morley. When he walks in at the beginning with that cane and smashes that table decoration to smithereens, you know he was born to play this role.
Yeah, you know, we're always asked, what's a good movie for the whole family to see? I think this is a case where I'd say yes. I can't really imagine anyone seeing this picture and not enjoying it.
I agree. Now for something more serious, Days of Heaven. This is one of the year's most beautiful and most emotionally powerful movies. And it's the story of a time in American history when immigrants went west to work the land, and some found wealth and some found romance, but others found only poverty in an early grave. The movie stars Sam Shepard as a rich young Texas farmer who falls in love with Brooke Adams as a field worker from Chicago. And here's a scene where the farmer finally gets up enough courage to ask her to stay on his farm.
Probably be all done by tomorrow. You still plan on going north? Mm-hmm. The reason I ask is, maybe you'd like to stay on here. Well, it'd be easier than it is now. There's not that much work after the harvest. Pay's just as good. It's an idea. You could think about it, let me know later.
I gotta run.
Who's that?
My brother.
Doesn't have any family either. Why don't you tell him you'll stay?
What for?
I don't know. Something might happen. What's your mouth hanging open for? Don't tell me. I already know. All I count your unhappy life. All I... Well, I'm telling you, we gotta do something about it. Can't expect anybody else to.
That's a talented newcomer named Richard Gere, and he's not really her brother, he's her husband. Well, in spite of that, she eventually does marry the farmer to get his money, and that's the beginning of a human tragedy for everyone in this picture, because eventually their secret is discovered, and they try to escape down a river. Now, in this spellbinding scene, we meet a young 12-year-old girl. She's the narrator of the whole film, and listen to her in this scene. Listen to her sad voice. It's got an infinitely weary wisdom.
Nobody's perfect. There was never a perfect person around. You just got half devil and half angel in you. She promised herself she'd lead a good life from now on. She blamed it all on herself. She didn't care if she was happy or not. She just wanted to make up for what she did wrong.
We found cops.
The sun looks ghostly when there's a mist on a river and everything's quiet. I never knowed it before. You could see people on the shore, but it was far off and you couldn't see what they were doing. They were probably calling for help or something, or they were trying to bury somebody or something. We seen trees that the leaves are shaking and it looks like shadows of guys coming at you and stuff. We heard owls squawking away, hooting away. We didn't know where we were going, what we were gonna do. I've never been on a boat before. That was the first time.
That's Linda Manns, and what a great voice she has. It's unforgettable, and I love that scene. It's, the whole movie is that beautiful. And Days of Heaven is really, it's two things at once. It's, first of all, a magnificently photographed record of life on the Great Plains before World War I. And then it's the story of how people can get cornered, how they can become overcome by desperation, poverty, their own uncertainty about what to do next. The movie was directed by a brilliant young filmmaker named Terrence Malick, and it's only his second film, but it's a masterpiece.
You know what I like about this picture is something that the movies can do so well when they're really good, and that is make you forget you're in a movie seat, take you away to a totally different world. In a way, this picture is as strange and as foreign with its photography and sounds as Star Wars, and I really think it's very beautiful. The voice, I don't know, maybe it's a little too much ain't the working class really smarter than the so-called smart guys, but my God, what a film to take us away from movies.
I agree, and one of the nice things is you have this love triangle and you think, oh no, not another soap opera on the plains or something, but nature is so big and so overwhelming. The sky is so big, the plains are so wide that the story just seems to fit into that and as its own kind of little rural tragedy.
It's sort of a hopeless story, though, too. I felt sad. Well, now we move to something a little bit lighter. It was announced last year, Roger, as you know, that Diana Ross was going to star in The Wiz, the black version of The Wizard of Oz. And a lot of people, I think, were upset then, because after all, the lead in the original Judy Garland movie and in the black musical was a teenage girl. So with Diana Ross, suddenly the question was going to be, was The Wiz going to be turned into a glitzy one-woman show? Well, it turns out the casting of Diana Ross was a terrific decision. She's superb as a nervous Nellie schoolteacher thrown into the world of Oz. There, she is told to follow a yellow brick road to a wizard who can help her get home. And along the way, she meets a scarecrow who wants the wizard to give him a brain. That scarecrow, played by Michael Jackson of the old Jackson 5, he tells Diana Ross to relax, to ease on down the road.
Say, what's your name?
My name is Dorothy.
Dorothy and Toto. What intelligent names. Okay, Dorothy and Toto, seems like we're gonna have to find our own yellow brick road.
Ease on down. Ease on.
Down the road.
Oh, there it is.
Oh. Ease on down. Ease on. Down the road.
Oh.
Oh. Don't you carry nothing. That might be a load.
There it is.
Dorothy, look!
Oh.
Dorothy!
Oh. Oh. Oh.
Ta-da! Woo! Come on, Dorothy! Come on!
That's a beautiful image of her dancing down that road, so tiny, and yet she really draws our attention. Now, eventually, Diana Ross does collect the Tin Man and a lion to round out her usual gang. They meet the Wiz and are required to kill an evil witch named Eveline, who's running a garment district sweatshop. Dorothy and the gang bump off Queenie, and that causes everybody, including the long-suffering workers, to sing It's a Brand New Day.
Thank you.
Ross is terrific there. In terms of movie musicals, I think Barbara Streisand just got some heavy competition. But I have mixed feelings about the film. It looks terrific, beautiful costumes, scenery, sets, and makeup. And that scene of Diana Ross dancing down that road, it's superior musical theater. But I guess I just don't buy the way the film repeatedly lays on its heavy message that you can find whatever you want in life inside yourself. For my money, The Wiz is just plain Diana Ross singing and dancing beautifully. She practically wills the fantasy of this film to come true. In this film, for sure, she's a real star.
She is a real star. I don't agree with you, though, that she's the whole film. I thought Nipsey Russell was great as the Tin Man. I love Michael Jackson. I love the choreography. There should be awards for the sets, for the costumes. Sidney Lumet's direction, I think it's in the great tradition of the American musical.
Wouldn't you like to see him shorten it up a little bit there? A couple of scenes that run on long.
They could take a couple of scenes out, but it's fun. Mm-hmm. It's worth going to see, that's for sure. And here's an altogether different movie that's also kind of about life in the Big Apple. And it also has charm and humor and a lot of vitality. It's called Girlfriends. And it's about two young women who are roommates in New York City. Now, one of them is a poet. She's really more interested in marriage than in a career, but the other one is a photographer, and weddings and bar mitzvahs and birthdays so far, but she'd love to sell her pictures to a magazine or an art gallery. And here's a scene in a laundromat where they both have big news for each other.
And you won't believe it. You're going to be famous and I'm going to be famous.
Tell me, what happened?
I did it. They're taking three of my pictures. Three pictures, and one of them is of you.
Oh, Susan, it's fantastic.
Which ones? One of the kids, the one of David's feet, and one of the morning ones with you.
But I'm half naked.
Oh, you're not naked, Anne. They love the lighting. That was their favorite one.
Oh, Susan,
I'm going to get famous. Isn't that incredible? No more bar mitzvahs.
I'm so excited. It's fantastic.
No more weddings.
One more wedding?
Never, never. I'll never do another wedding again. Annie, I can't believe it. They love them.
My wedding?
What do you mean you're not getting married?
I'm getting married.
What?
Martin and I are.
Annie. That's great.
That's kind of tricky, isn't it? The way the two kinds of happiness sort of clash. The one about a career, the other about a marriage. The whole movie is sort of a balancing act, especially for Melanie Mayron, who is the girl who plays the photographer. She loses her roommate, she plunges into her career, and then, what do you know, she even finds a boyfriend.
What are you doing?
I'm going to call your mother.
Why?
Well, she'll remember if you have them.
Well, Susan, I mean, couldn't we do this later? I mean, what's the big deal about the mumps, anyway?
If you didn't have them when you were a kid, okay, and you get them now, when you're an adult, you know what happens to you? They leave you sterile.
914.
Yes. Yes.
SO38318. Mom, I just wanted to ask you a question. I was wondering if I ever had the mumps. No. No, I'm not sick. I feel fine. I just had to. I have to fill in some forms for a teaching job, and I remember having, you see, the measles and everything. But I just didn't remember having. Well, maybe you could check with Dad. You know. Oh, you sure?
You know, Gene, I've seen that film three times, and every time he gives the telephone number, it always gets a laugh. Girlfriends was made on a shoestring. It's a labor of love, a warm and entertaining movie that has something to say about the way we live now. I think a lot of us live next door to people like the characters in this movie.
You know, I wish that they had stuck more with what the title of the film is, Girlfriends. I find it's just much more about that second girl that we saw, Melanie Mayron. She's wonderful, but I wish there was a little bit more clashing of the two characters.
Uh-oh, Gene, this Bowser in the balcony means it's time for Dog of the Week, a regular feature where each of us picks the week's worst movie.
Well, Roger, you and Spot may not believe this, but I have just seen my first nudie karate film.
You're kidding.
No, I guess you'd call that genre chop sexy. The film is The Bod Squad. Five nubile Western girls are sold into slavery in Asia, where they are bought and sexually abused by some Oriental bad guys. Wearing Fredericks of Osaka costumes, these women get off their feet in strange ways for sex objects. Their specialty, violent massage to the brain as they bump and grind their way to freedom. Most laughable is that one of the girls falls in love with a nice Oriental guy named Ho-Ho, a regular ding-dong, and a great moment in movie history comes when this girl says with a straight face to her boyfriend, I love you, Ho-Ho.
Well, Ho-Ho-Ho, gee, maybe she's in love with the Jolly Green Giant. Anyway, my dog this week has a great set of canines. It's Count Dracula and his vampire bride. The vampire is played by Christopher Lee, and he has great taste in necks. He could drain the bod squad in 20 minutes. This guy has come back from the dead so often, he ought to rent his grave by the month. Anyway, after a little coy necking with his bride-to-be, he puts her on a sacrificial altar in a phony ceremony that looks like a cut-rate 4th of July. Hollywood has a lot of new vampire movies coming out in the works, and I believe me that they got to be all uphill from here.
I'm sure you're right. So much for the dogs. Now let's take a look at the major movies on this show. We think Who is Killing the Great Chefs of Europe is a delightful comedy starring Robert Morley as a priggish and piggish gourmet. Both Roger and I like it a lot. That's why it says yes next to both of our names. We recommend you see this movie. And we both say yes to Days of Heaven, a hauntingly beautiful film about migrant farm workers before the First World War. Girlfriends gets our recommendation, too. Roger likes its realism and sense of humor. I don't think it's enough about Girlfriends. The Big Fix, starring Richard Dreyfuss, gets a split decision. Roger gives it a yes. I think it's too preachy, and I give it a no. I don't recommend you see The Big Fix. Both Roger and I say yes to The Wiz. Diana Ross is just great in it.
And that's it for this show. Next on Sneak Previews, we'll show you scenes from Midnight Express, a thriller about a young American in a brutal Turkish jail. Paradise Alley with Sylvester Stallone as a tough gang leader, and Magic, the terrifying love and murder story about a ventriloquist. Until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Funding for this program is provided by this station and by other public television stations.